almost like this is the Jimmy Webb show. You know, he wrote so many amazing songs. So, this is Gary Stockdale.
Thank you, Don. Don Peake, everyone.
Marty Ross. I've never met him though.
This is a great song written by Jimmy Webb, made famous by Glenn Campbell.
Linda Ronstadt was 17 years old. She was with a group called the Stone Ponies. And they were appearing at a little club in Topanga Canyon. And a friend of mine who I had worked with before, by the name of Nick Benet, was her producer at that time. And he says, wait till you hear this. You won't believe this voice on this little chick. I said, okay, you know. And we go to do the date, and I walk in and I see this beautiful giant harpsichord. And the first thing I said was, who's playing that? He said, well, you are. And I said, well, okay. And now I'm scared to death because I think they're going to write some kind of part that Bach would have written, or Mozart, you know. And fortunately for me, when I came to my solo on the harpsichord, the music said, rock and roll Bach style. And that was it, with a bunch of chords. And that's how we ended up doing it. And she had two guitar players that were with her in the Stone Ponies band that put these finger picks on. And they played with finger picks, and they were amazing to watch. And of course, it was at Capitol Records, and it was a great session. And that was my first time with Linda. And Mike Nesbitt wrote the song.
You know, there's a gentleman that I know named Walter Mirisch, and he wrote a book, and the title of the book, I think, really applies to us also. I don't mean to be pretentious or presumptuous, but what he said, the title of his book was, I Thought We Were Making Movies, Not History. So here we are, Don Randi was making history.
Seen some of those movies. Some of
terrible.
Those,
they were terrible movies.
Worst songs. I mean, they would grind them out. And sure enough, on the session, the producer and director said, to Billy Strange and Mac Davis, who are the songwriters on this. We need one more song. Okay, band, take a break. We take a break, 10-minute break. We come back. It's not ready. Take another 10-minute break. Well, we took about four 10-minute breaks, and it finally got to the point of where they had some idea, and we're talking about it. I'm thinking there's some chords, a few notes, and Hal Blaine came up with the idea. I'll start it with the drums, and then Billy said, oh, okay, I'll come in the car. I said, I'll wait 10 bars, and I'll come in. And that's how the song, there was a new song, but that little less conversation went into the movie, and it wasn't very popular for a number of years after that. But fortunately, the initial payment was $67.50. But it has been done so many times in different television shows and different recordings and reuse, and somebody did a disco version, and it's made us a fortune. It's close to 10 grand now over the last 30 years. Thank you. Thank you, Elvis.
Guitar, but it's actually what they call a baritone, and it goes so it's a baritone. So there's a song that goes like this. Go ahead, George.
Singing in the wild, I can And I want you for all time. And the witch you told me is still on the
does not have there's no song, and it's all because of this gentleman right over here, Mr. Chuck Berghofer. She had a tough enough time convincing Lee Hazelwood to let her sing it. He said, no, this is a guy song. No, she said, no, this is a girl song. And they argued over it, and finally she won out, thank God. And if not for Chuck, this is amazing. Tell a story. You know it.
Well, we did. Yeah, it was weird because I think it was the last tune we were going to do in this session. And he wanted to forget about it. And, you know, oh, no, I love it. Anyway, we wound up doing it. We made about six takes on it. And the bass part was written a little different than I wound up playing it. But I've got a copy at home somewhere. I've been able to find it lately. But it shows all the different things, the way it moved into the, what.
Well, show us how the original part went.
Hold on.
Yeah.
I'm
interesting thing because Glenn Campbell and Al Casey were the guitar players on it. At the beginning of that record, he's a guitar. And Glenn was playing it. And Frank Sinatra in the booth heard it. He said, no, that's not what it was. Glenn wasn't quite getting it right. And Al Casey, who was a very sweetheart, groovy guy, very gentle guy, said to Glenn, do you mind? I played it on the demo for that record. I know exactly what he wants. And Glenn said, well, goddamn sure, you play it. So that's Al Casey that plays the beginning of that song. But Frank heard it. He knew that it wasn't exactly what he wanted. Pretty interesting. Has nothing to do with this next song.
I went to a college with C. Carson Park's son, Rick.
Oh, really?
Yes. C. Carson Park's wrote something stupid. So.
Now, what has happened here is that the magic conveyor belt has brought in John Rosen. And it's quite amazing because he makes something look easy that is not easy. Turn up your volume, please, and give us some. Let us see what this is.
Guys were known as the best readers and jazzers and everybody in town, and they called them up because they said, you guys can get this pop stuff done really quick, right? And they would. They were known as being the quickest, the fastest, and the best, and they still are, in my opinion, this late in the game.
Well, Marty, it also, because these bands, the actual guys couldn't really play that well.
Right.
And they needed somebody to make the
How'd you like to be in your own cover band?
Yeah, right.
This one's by sung by Harry Nilsson, and this is dedicated to the folks that are listening there out there on Monkey Mania Radio, and that's a thing that I DJ. And I love this song because Harry...
Did you just throw in a commercial?
No, I got you more listeners.
That wasn't in the script.
No. It's actually in here.
It's all right, he paid for it.
Yeah, it's $20 per...
Guard!
In any case... This song's Everybody's Talking, and it was a big hit for Harry. It established him, and he was such a force. I worked with him on a few things and drank a lot with him. And he was fun to drink with until 4 in the morning, and then that stopped.
And he was a really good songwriter.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. He wrote a lot of hit songs, too, but he didn't sing on any of his own. So this is Harry Nilsson singing Everybody's Talking, and Gary and I are going to rip this thing in half. We're going to just do it right. This will be fun. I'm really confident.
Stop and stare.
Albert, there's got to be a place. Come on. All right. Albert Lee, ladies and gentlemen. Okay. So, there's a reason why I'm telling this, and you'll find out if you don't interrupt me again. Okay, River Deep was 3 years later, and it was going to be Phil Spector's greatest record. And again, we were in the studio. Phil would make us rehearse and rehearse, maybe take 30. You know, we recorded this song. So now we're going to do it for the show, and we have to find a singer. See, that's the connection, Lauri. Okay, so Lauri says, I know somebody named Carol Lee that can sing this song. And I said, no, nobody can sing this song. And she said, wait till the rehearsal. And Carol Lee came in and tore down the studio. So here it is. This is Phil Spector's greatest record. Unfortunately, it was a big hit in England. It's all over Europe. But in the U.S., it was a bomb, and Phil stopped recording and left the country.
But no, stop. Take two.
Doctor told me I only had 2 weeks to live. I'd rather spend them with you because each moment is like an eternity. And Sonny Bono says, gee, thanks, Barney. So we are going to play for you F.
The beat goes down.
it's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, that's for sure.
It's definitely a huge song. It's a Righteous Brothers song, and it's one of those things where Gary and I are going to really do this song, hopefully justice, because it's a real high wire act. We're going to do this really well. I just have a confidence.
Did he just say high wire act?
It is a high wire act.
What does that mean?
On vocals, it means that we're way up there.
Guard.
You've called the guard twice.
And there's a reason for that.
And I paid the guard off.
John DePatie has picked up the 12-string guitar.
Yeah.
Hey, John.
Right there. Is it a great band?
Yeah.
All right, starting all the way to my far right, that's John Rosen over there on banjo. Back in that percussion section, we've got Kyle Wittlin, Billy Hulting, and then our favorite drummer, George Green. In the fancy, colorful jacket over here in this corner. I feel like it's a boxing match. In this corner. There's Eric Ekstrand. So behind me over here is John DePatie on guitar. And then all of our amazing singers here in a cluster. Next to me is Kiki Ebsen. Cara. Marty Ross, and then our wrecking crew. We've got Chuck Berghofer here on bass. The captain, John Peake, our captain. John Randi, our co-captain. And before we do this final number, I want to thank Bogie. I'm Lauri.
Lauri Reimer. She makes this thing happen. All the stuff behind here, everything you see, it's her that did this, and she set the she made the set list. She's incredible. She's the hardest worker. Give her a great round of applause. And she's very talented as well. So you got a triple threat going.
I don't blush often. Okay.
And you are invited to sing along on this one. The lyrics are very complicated. They're partly in Latin and partly in Aramaic. But if you just say, "Help me, Rhonda," that'll work.
Yeah.
Yeah.